chains around me. Gonna learn to fly again. Maybe hard, but I'll do it. When I'm back on my feet again, soon these tears will all be drying. Soon these eyes will see the sun. Might take time, but I'll see it. When I'm back on my feet again, when I'm back.
I'm not afraid to die. Okay, I've had enough of that. We're going to do something new. This is called I Don't Fuck With You by Big Sean.
You, you little stupid ass bitch, I ain't fucking with you. You little dumb ass bitch, I ain't fucking with you. I got a million trillion things I'd rather fucking do than to be fucking with you. Little stupid ass, I don't give a fuck, I don't give a fuck, I don't give a fuck, bitch, I don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do, don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do. I heard you got a new man, I see you taking the pic, then you post it up, thinking that it's making me sick, I see you calling, I be making it quick, I'ma answer that shit like I don't fuck with you. Bitch, I got no feelings to go. I swear I had it up to here, I got no feelings to go. I mean, for real, fuck how you feel. Fuck it too, sis, if it ain't going towards the bill. Yeah, and every day I wake up celebrating shit. Why? Cause I just dodged the bullet from a crazy bitch. I stuck to my guns, that's what made me rich. That's what put me on, that's what got me here. That's what made me this. And everything that I do is my first name. Yeah, these hoes chase bread, aw damn, she got a bird brain. Ain't nothing but trilling me, aw man, silly me. I just bought a crib, 3 stories, that bitch a trilogy. And you know I'm rolling, we just fucking up the ozone. I got a bitch that text me, she ain't got no clothes on. And then another one text me, yo ass next. And I'ma text your ass back like I don't fuck with you. You little stupid ass bitch, I ain't fucking with you. You little dumb ass bitch, I ain't fucking with you. I got a million trillion things I'd rather fucking do than to be fucking with you. Little stupid ass, I don't give a fuck, I don't give a fuck, I don't give a fuck, bitch, I don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do. Don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do.
Got a million things on my mind, executive deals online, limited amount of time, chasing these dollar signs, and you ain't on your grind. You liable to find me up in the MGM casino in the deep. Fucking off Eddie, I could've put on property. From the beta to murder it, my niggas put murder mission. She choosing, that's her decision. Free my niggas in prison. On the phone with a bitch who can't do shit for a pimp, but make a nigga hella rich. Got a blunt and my dental, blowing hemp and a rental. On my way to Sacramento, late night, Arsenio. I'm never sentimental, go hard or go homeless. Really, hardly, I'm chromeless. You might end up domeless. I bet you she into me, her cheddar she giving me. Bitch stand outside forever like the Statue of Liberty. Rest in Pimp C, underground king of the South. I raise my styrofoam up and pull some drink in my mouth. Why you always coming around with bad news?
Bad news.
Say you want me to win, but hope I lose.
Hope I lose.
I never rock with other niggas in the crew. But them niggas cool. It's just that.
Bitch, I ain't fucking with you.
Bitch.
You little stupid ass bitch, I ain't fucking with you. You little dumb ass bitch, I ain't fucking with you. I got a million trillion things I'd rather fucking do than to be fucking with you. Little stupid ass, I don't give a fuck, I don't give a fuck, I don't give a fuck, bitch, I don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do. Don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do. I don't give a fuck, I don't give a fuck, I don't give a fuck, bitch. I don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do. Don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do.
I got a new chick that I gotta thank God for. I got a new whip that I gotta thank the lot for. Yeah, I got a lot, but want a lot more. Yeah, we in the building, but I'm trying to take it to the top floor. I swear I hear some new bullshit every day I'm waking up. It seems like nowadays everybody breaking up. That shit could break you down if you lose a good girl. I guess you need a bad bitch to come around and make it up. I guess drama makes for the best content. Everything got a bad side, even the conscience. Now you're drinking till you're unconscious. Feel me when you get a fine bitches. Don't forget to read the fine print. Life got me meditating like I'm in the Himalayas. Keep a G with the L it on me like the elevator. Yeah, I know that karma too real, so I hope you doing cool. But still, stupid ass bitch, I ain't fucking with you. Little stupid ass, I ain't fucking with you.
Your name, I love you just the
should run away. I would save your place so you can go, go, go. If you want to, I wouldn't try and stop you. I couldn't say a thing. You flicker, flicker.
Control like you're playing around us.
Okay. I'm here. And she just finally walked out. Uh-oh. Stop, 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 stop. Thank you. When we need you, we'll call you. Okay. We are here on Sunday night. You know what I'm going to say? You all know what I'm going to say before I even say it. You know what I'm going to say. Oh, boy. How many people out there know what I'm going to say? Okay. It is Sunday night, the second day of November, a day I'll always remember, because that was the day. What? What happened? Then my daddy died. You know you love it.
You keep slapping that BS. Left us was a loan. It doesn't mean that we had a loan at the bank or he loaned us some money before he died. He left us a loan. A wonderful play on words, a well-written song by a group that should live in infamy. Now, I have showed you that I know new music. My daughter was helping me play some music. I knew the music, but I didn't know the music, actually the words, I mean the names of the songs. And I know old music. I know country, I know rock, I know techno, I know heavy metal, I know wagon step, dubstep, all of that stuff. But we're going to talk about, those are my fingernails, we are going to talk about the temptations for a minute because they were so great. The temptations were five gentlemen that got together, I believe, in the year 1966. We're going to make sure that we're talking about the truth here. We're going to talk about a few things. The temptations, all right? And I think this is important to talk about. This is called music appreciation in one form or another. All right? It teaches you to appreciate some of the greatest things that ever happened to music, and that was the Temptations. The Temptations are an American group known for their success with Motown during the 1960s and the 70s. They were most noted for their choreography, their extremely distinct harmony, and their flashy wardrobes. They were highly influential to the evolution of R&B and soul. They sold tens of millions of albums. The Temptations are one of the most successful groups in music history. Now, in 2014, the Temptations continue to perform with one of the original members, who is named Otis Williams. Featuring five male vocalists and dancers, the group formed in 1960 in Detroit, Michigan, under the name The Elgins. The original founding members were original members of two rival Detroit vocal groups, Otis Williams, Al Bryant, thank you, Melvin Franklin, and Eddie Kendricks and Paul Williams of the Primes. In 1964, Bryant was replaced by David Ruffin, who was the lead vocalist in a number of the group's biggest hits, including My Girl and Ain't Too Proud to Beg and I Wish It Would Rain. Ruffin was then replaced in 1968 by Dennis Edwards, with whom the group continued to record hit records such as Cloud Nine and Ball of Confusion in 1970. The group's lineup has changed frequently since the departure of Kendricks and Paul Williams from the act of 1971. Over the course of their career, the Temptations have released four Billboard Hot 100 number ones and 14 number one singles. I'm going to repeat that. Released four Billboard Hot 100 number ones and 14 R&B number ones. And they have won 3 Grammys. They were also given the 2013 Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award. One of their biggest songs they won a Grammy for was Cloud Nine. They won that in 1969. Now, Papa Was a Rolling Stone, 3 classic Temptations songs, My Girl, Just My Imagination, and Papa Was a Rolling Stones, are among Rock and Roll's Hall of Fame top 500 songs that shaped rock and roll. They are also ranked at number 68 in Rolling Stone's top 100 greatest all-time bands or groups. Okay. Now, Eddie Kendricks and Paul Williams began singing together in a church as children. By their teenage years, they formed a doo-wop group, a quartet, in 55 with Kel Osborne and Willie Waller, naming themselves the Cavaliers. And then it just goes on and on and on and on. Now, when they first got into Motown, that's an interesting story. They wanted into Motown, and it was crazy. All right, let me tell you how they got into Motown. It says, do-do-do-do-do, pretty interesting. But first, let's talk about the 1972 release of Papa Was a Rolling Stone. It was a magnum opus written by Norman Whitfield and co-written by Barry Strong and produced by Whitfield. Originally, it was a 3-minute record written and produced for The Undisputed Truth, another band. Whitfield took the somber tune and created a sprawling, dramatic 12-minute version for The Temptations, a forerunner for the extended single soon to become popular in clubs and discotheques. An edited 7-minute version was released as a single and became one of the longest hit singles in music history. It hit number one on the pop charts, number one on the R&B charts. In 73, Papa Was a Rolling Stone won the Temptations their second Grammy for Best R&B Performance by a Group. And Paul Reiser won for the same song Best R&B Instrumental Performance for the instrumental version on the B-side. After Papa Was a Rolling Stone, Whitfield stopped working with Barrett Strong and began writing the Temptations material on his own. The success of Papa led Whitfield to create more elongated operatic pieces, including masterpieces such as Masterpiece. One of their bigger, more recent than anything was when they did one of the biggest hits they did, I think that everybody out there would know that knows anything about them, would be, well, let's just take a little walk down memory lane. I'll show you what they did. Here's one of their big hits. Okay, let me check my volume first. Okay, check this one out. His woman is leaving him, and he's like, I am not too proud to beg. I will get on my knees.
For your sympathy, I don't mind, cause you mean that much to me. Ain't too proud to beg, and you know it. Please don't leave me, girl. Ain't too proud to plead, baby, baby. Please don't leave me, girl. Now I heard
hits, a song about a guy that's seeing things. He's missing his girl so bad.
Mm-hmm. Each day through my window, I watch her as she passes by. I say to myself, you're such a lucky guy to have a girl like her. It's truly a dream.
This is like a puff puff pass, except I'm a gulp gulp drink. I'm drinking Dasani water. It's the best tasting water in the world, and I know it's probably somebody's tap water, but I don't care. It still tastes good. Heather goes, just let me know if you want some more music, Mom. Should we get Heather back on the tunes? Steve Rush, call the show. You stupid mullet. Well, I know that her and Mr. Midnight Movie and Jewish Producer are mad at each other. No, we're not. We're not mad at each other. They're mullets, and I love them. And there were mullets last night. They were in mullet mode. Let's see. Let's do one more here for the Temptations. I'm thinking about what to play. Okay, wait, let's see. Let's do something else. Let's do... Who is it?
Pizza Man.
Pizza Man. I just got pizza bombed by my husband. What kind of pizza is it, Vic?
The big 12-inch.
In whose dream? Yours or mine? So, I don't like Papa sausage. John's. I don't want it.
That's cheese deal.
I don't want it.
This barbecue deal.
I don't want it.
No?
No, I don't want it. Thank you. Papa John's pizza's gross. It's all bread. Thank you, Precious. You didn't have to bring all that in here.
You have to get thin crust with him.
Honey, you are so sweet. I'm so spoiled. Honey, quit loving me so much.
I don't know.
Honey, I think you love me too much. All right, stop loving me so much. My family is so weird. I don't know what else to play. I don't even know why I'm on the air. I don't even know if anybody's listening. I don't even care. I'm just doing this for myself. I'm just on here with me and me and only me. I have two computers thanks to PIMPHAT. PIMPHAT's a genius. I had to purchase a computer, and I went and purchased a computer, and I bought exactly what PIMPHAT told me to buy. Got home, and I had totally forgot to ask the gentleman, does it have Windows 7 or Windows 8? And it had Windows 8. Windows 8 is an impossible program to do. Operating system. It's stupid. So if you ever get around anything that says Windows 8, run. Don't walk away from it. It's ridiculous. So I go back to Best Buy and say, hi, do you not have any computers in the store that have Windows 7? Oh, no, ma'am, that's practically extinct. Well, it just so happens when I got home, Victor found a brand new, out-of-the-box HP Pavilion 15-inch, whatever this is. Well, it was locked. Some girl had bought it to pay for a bail bond, not for collateral, but to actually pay Victor for it. And before she brought it to the office, she put her name and put a password on it. Never been used before. So I asked PIMPHAT, how do you crack an HP Pavilion? And he was like, hell, I don't know. And then he came up with this way of doing it. I gave it to Steven. Steven took it out, did the thing he told him to do, and boom, it was absolutely worked like a charm. It said, welcome to your new HP Pavilion, and it's now sitting here next to me. And I'm looking at it right here, and I'm so happy. I don't know that anything's on it. No, there's no music. Windows Media Player. It's got everything on. It's pretty cool, though, but I am so not used to doing Windows. But nonetheless, it is here, and works great. I can play solitaire, I know that. When I hit start, it has all programs, and it's got Acrobat, Adobe Reader, eBay, Hulu Desktop, Internet Explorer, Microsoft Office PowerPoint Viewer, Microsoft Works, Pandora Internet Radio, Windows Anytime Upgrade, Windows Media Player, Windows Fax and Scan, Windows DVD, Windows Update Accessories, lots of stuff. Oh, I just hit solitaire by accident. Let me close that.
No, make it. We're just telling us, you know, stop coughing.
I have some cough drop, cough syrup that he can't have. It's my lean since I'm a drug addict. So when this Macintosh is sitting here going, she's got a Windows computer next to us, getting nervous. Back to the Temptations. Let's look up and see what else we can play. The Temptations were great. Another person that was great in Motown was Smokey Robinson. When Smokey sings, Mr. Midnight Movie hates that song. When Smokey sings, Mr. Midnight Movie. He's so stupid. What else do you have? Let's see. Smokey Robinson. No, let's show him some of our music, Victor. Some of our favorite music, which is... Uh-oh, here's Heather. Heather, I need another song.
Hey, you didn't come up with that word stoop.
Yes, I did.
No, you did not. Bet me everything I own.
Who did?
Y'all don't know where you got it from? Just the movie in there, True Lies. I can rewind it right now.
When did she say stoop?
Whenever they first kicked ass in the very beginning, and he's giving him his driver's license and passport. He goes, Harry Tasker, passport, Harry Tasker, this. And he hands him the snow globe, and he goes, what's this? He goes, it's a, what is it called when you get a souvenir? He goes, a souvenir for Dana, stoop.
Oh, I've always said stoopy boop.
Yeah, she said it way before.
You're yeah, I was before you True Lies.
Said stoop, and I was like, oh, I'm not sure.
She did.
Anyways.
Give me another song.
What do you want?
I don't care. Do,
you... I'm capping my girl.
Hey, they make more money than you do.
Give me one of your raps.
A rap?
Hey, they make more money than you do. What? A rap one.
He's just always talking shit.
He's a shit talker.
Jeezy.
Your nails do look like shit.
I don't care. I'd rather have a tan than nails.
You have to talk pretty to mommy for suntan. Jeezy.
He's so fine.
Ooh, he is cute. Here we go. From Jeezy. It's called I Mean It. I mean it.
Here's Jeezy this.
These things happen. Yeah.
If I ever said I'm never scared, you know I mean it. If I ever said I fuck your bitch, just know I mean it. And if I ever said I'm getting money, just know I mean it. And oh Lord knows, he knows I mean it.
Yeah.
You know,
said that shit, then I mean it. She calls me, I screen it. I'm only fucking if it's convenient. You lie on pussy, that's weak shit. We pass pussy round, that's G shit. But you ain't fam, so what is this we shit? You cup.
This guy is not only white, but he looks like a librarian or something. He looks like you wouldn't believe this is coming out of this person.
They all stare like, who the fuck is this dude? Kick's game is just rude. Don't get jujitsu'd. Tunnel visions, I get ahead. Stay solid, I never fled. My haters feel like I'm better dead. But I'm quite alive, getting bread instead. With a better girl, with a better face. I'm in a better place, getting better head. I just wanna stay broke forever. Yeah, that's that shit no one ever said.
Never scared. Just know I mean it. If I ever said I fuck your bitch. I'm getting money, just know I mean it.
Signed, Gerald, I'm sincere. This year, I'm in here. I'll spell it out to make things clear. And meanwhile, your end's near. I've got a lane and I'm in gear. You people wonder who's next up. That conversation really ends here. You rappers just talk a bunch. Stress me out, I chop a Dutch. Weak rappers trying to bite the sound, but my style is a lot to munch. And I'm more like whiskey neat, and you're more like vodka punch. G's dope, you might blow up. Think I know, I've got a hunch. On my side, it's authentic. You try to stump it, it's all rented. Sure dope, you got a bad chick. Yeah, cool, bro, we all get it. She wears a ring, can't do without it. You really think she stays true? I doubt it. Cause I'm fucking your girlfriend, and there's nothing you can do about it.
I'm never scared. Just know I mean it. Fuck your bitch. Just know I mean it. And if I ever said I'm getting money, just know I mean it. And oh Lord knows, he knows I mean it. Just know I mean it. Just know I mean it. Just know I mean it. Just know.
That I would listen to that definitely again. All right, we're going to move over to some music from my son Steven. Take it away to show you what I live with over here.
Hear that lonesome whippoorwill, he sounds too blue to fly. The midnight train is whining low. I'm so lonesome I could cry. I've never seen a night so long when time goes crawling by. The moon just went behind the clouds to hide its face and cry.
Okay, that's the smooth sounds of Hank Williams from 1905, probably. Hell, Hank Williams Jr. had a boy named Hank Williams II, or Hank, excuse me, this is Hank Williams. He had a son. They called him Hank Williams Jr., also known as Bocephus. Bocephus was a nickname that he gave himself. Bocephus was more of a country rock person. He sort of put a different spin on music. But then came Hank Williams III. Hank Williams III was run out of Nashville. He was told to get the hell out of Nashville because he was not what they wanted. He was a renegade. He actually was asked to leave Nashville. He was kicked out. And he said in the song, in response to being kicked out of Nashville, is, I put the dick in Dixie and the cunt back in country. And my son fell head over heels for Hank Williams III because, number one, they drive the same truck and they have the same dog. And he just thinks he's the neatest thing since the sliced bread. Now, Hank Williams III actually plays Hank Williams originals. He has his grandfather's face. He has his grandfather's attitude. His grandfather was a rebel. He is probably in his young 30s. Late 20s, I don't know. But recently, about 2 years ago, Stephen was, he and his friends went over to Fort Worth to see Hank Williams III. They took Stephen for his birthday, and they got front row tickets and stayed right up at the front. They went backstage afterwards. They didn't get to meet him, but they got real close to him. They said they had pictures taken. And there's a song that Hank Williams III does that is called, by all of Stephen's friends, Jason, Tyler, every one of them say it's Stephen's song. It's called, ouch, that hurts. It's called Crazed Country Rebel. And the reason they say that this is Stephen's song is they say that if you listen to the words, it sounds just like he's talking about Stephen. My son. Yeah, it's different over here. My kids are like polar opposites. But the lyrics to Crazed Country Rebel, to show you what I'm dealing with, it says, I was rolling by myself, went down to Memphis, Tennessee. I was looking for a guy who had a mullet and no teeth. I was tripping on some acid a Latino gave to me. I was smoking morphine till it knocked me off my feet. Then I scored some H from my old Uncle Pete, and I started to feel like I might have OD'd. On an overdose of drugs, an overdose of sin, I'm going to live it to the fullest like I'm on 10, and I love getting high, I hate being low, and I love to drive my truck down a muddy dirt road. I'm working real hard, I'm trying to get paid, because I'm a crazed country rebel, and I'm drifting state to state. Somehow I made it up to Texas with a carload full of grass. I'm seeing all these pigs who want to bust my ass, and I'm always living hard. I'm always smoking weed. Now I'm hanging out in Texas drinking mushroom tea. I'm beeped up on the floor. I think I know why. It must have been some of that Boone County moonshine. I tried to get up off the floor, tried to get myself in line, because the ceiling's talking to me and the pisser's flushing fire. That's why they call me full throttle. I like a good time. It all started at a bar with a friend of mine. Had to hook me up, said he'd blow my mind. I've been up now for 4 days, so cut me out another line. I'm on an overdose of drugs, an overdose of sin. Gonna live it like I'm on 10. Here it is from Hank Williams III, my son's song, I guess. Until things changed. When he sang this, they pushed Stephen up on the stage, and Stephen got to be on the stage with him.
Well, I was rolling by myself, went down to Memphis, Tennessee, and I was looking for a guy, had a mullet and no teeth, and I was tripping on some massive little Latino gave to me. Yeah, I was smoking morphine till it knocked me off my feet. Then I got some age from my old. Now I'm starting to feel like I might have OD'd on an overdose of drugs, overdose of sin. I'm gonna live it to the fullest like I'm on 10. And I love getting high, I hate being low, and I like to drive my truck down a muddy dirt road. And I'm working real hard, trying to get paid, cause I'm a crazed country rebel and I'm drifting state to state. Somehow I made it up to Texas with a crawler full of grass, and I'm seeing all these pigs who want to bust my ass. And I'm always living hard, always smoking weed. And now I'm hanging out in Texas drinking mushroom tea, and I'm bucked up on the floor, and I think I know why. It must have been some of that Boone County moonshine. Overdose of drugs, overdose of sin. I'm gonna live it to the fullest like I'm on 10. And I love getting high, I hate being low, truck down a muddy dirt road. And I'm working real hard, trying to get paid, cause I'm a crazed country rebel and I'm drifting state to state.
All right, we interrupt this. Stand by, please. Thank you, Hank. We interrupt this broadcast to bring you, I've just been informed that on my son's YouTube page is the live version on July 9th of 2009, which was 5 years ago. Stephen was 18 when he was allowed to go. How about that? Here is the actual recording of Crazed Country Rebel. I have no idea how bad this is going to be. Here we go.
And to all you crazed, crunchy rebels hanging out tonight. Well, I was all up by myself, but down in Memphis, Tennessee, and I was looking for a guy, had a bullet and no teeth, and I was tripping on some acid, a Latino gave to me. I was smoking morphine till it knocked me off my feet. Then I got some age from my old orthopedic, and I'm starting to feel like I'm out of OD. Started overdosing drugs, overdose of sin, gonna live it to the fullest like I'm on 10, and I love getting high, hate being low, and I like to drive my truck down a muddy dirt road, and I'm working real hard, trying to get paid, cause I'm a crazed country rebel, and I'm drifting state to state. It up to Texas with a polo full of grass, and I'm seeing all these pigs who wanna bust my ass, and I'm always living hard, always smoking weed, and I'm hanging out in Texas drinking mushroom tea, fucked up on the floor, and I'm thinking, oh, I must have been some of that Boone County moonshine, and an overdose of drugs, overdose of sin, gonna live it to the fullest like I'm on 10. Country rebel, and I'm drifting state to state. Get up off the floor, I tried to get myself in line, cause the ceiling's talking to me, and the pressure's pushing fire, that's why they call me Full Throttle. I like a good time, it'll start it at a bar with a friend of mine, had to hook me up so sissy, blow my mind, and I've been up for 4 days, so cut me at another line. I've been overdose of drugs, overdose of sin, gonna leave it to the fullest like I'm on 10, and I love getting high, hate being drive my truck down a muddy dirt road, and I'm working real hard, trying to get paid, cause I'm a crazed country rebel, and I'm drifting state to state.
Thank you. Luckily, Stephen has hung up his title of Full Throttle and has now settled into Mr. I go to college, I work, and I do everything right, and I pay my bills on time, and my crazy days are over. But I am so glad, and I mean this, I am so glad that my son experienced that while still under the watchful eye of his father and I. Now, we never once ever partook in any kind of drug use with my son, nor did we condone any sort of drug use, but yet my son got involved in a group of men, young boys, men, young men that were experimenting with anything they could get their hands on. Now, Stephen, of course, never did acid. He's told me everything he did, but he did partake in several things, and he has lived his life in a way that I don't think I would change it if I could. I don't think I would go back and rewrite it. Stephen graduated from high school with honors. He is extremely respectful to his mother, to his father. He is a great, great, great person. Two people have met Stephen off the internet that I know through my radio, through my podcast here. One of them is Oro Shango, and one of them is Russell Taylor. They have both met Stephen, and they have both said in no uncertain terms that Stephen is quite possibly the coolest person they've ever met in their life. And, you know, I get so much bullshit on this thing by idiots on here, you know, jealous podcasters who say shit, women who say shit. But I'm going to tell you something. If you're going to judge me as a mother. If you're going to judge me as a mother, take a look at my kids. I mean, a lot of people try to say something stupid about Heather having a baby. Well, Heather could have easily trounced herself into an abortion clinic and had an abortion. But her father and I sat her down and said, that's not the way we do business. You got yourself into this predicament, you're going to handle it. She got an engagement ring on her finger by her boyfriend. She bought a wedding dress and bridesmaids' dresses. And then we found out that he was a devil in disguise. On the outside, he looked like a Marine with crew cut, strong, tall boy. Yes, sir. No, sir. And I mean to tell you, behind our back, he was a viper snake. He was abusing her. He was belittling her. He was talking bad to her. She was pregnant. He was the most horrible abuse. And I'll tell you what happened if you want to know the truth. The truth of the matter is this. After she had the baby, which that was a nightmare experience of its own going through with him, he laid in the hospital room and slept, nursing a hangover while she was trying to give birth to this baby. And he was horrible. I mean, that's the only way to describe him. One time the baby was 2 weeks old and she was over there in her apartment that her father and I had secured for her that he didn't pay a dime on. Her father and I were paying $1,000 a month to put her up in a really nice apartment that was brand new and clean for her and that baby. He was there with her. And my phone rang. I answered the phone. Hello. And I couldn't hear anything. But I knew it was my daughter because I saw the caller ID. I was in my office. Victor was somewhere in the house. I ran and screamed for Victor to come in there. Victor ran into the office and he said, what's wrong? I said, listen, I put it on the speakerphone. What Heather had done is she had dialed my number, laid her phone down on the bar just so that I could listen to the way he talked to her. She was holding the baby and crying and he was belittling her and telling her all of these horrible things. And it was all, didn't you leave and go over there?
Sure the fuck did.
I tried to calm Victor down. Victor was beside himself. And he stormed out of my office. The last thing I heard was that Land Cruiser start up and he was gone. By the time Victor drove up into the apartment, he had just drove off. The boy did. The kid.
I was coming.
Yeah, because he knew he was coming. I don't know what you would have done. You might have killed him. Because it was horrible what he was doing. So that is why she is not with him. it is the father of, it's Jet's father. And Jet knows who he is, and Jet, even at the age of 4, doesn't like him. The reason why is because he married a girl that is the identical twin of Heather. I mean, literally her identical twin, and had a baby. But before that, this girl was so unbelievably jealous and hateful of Heather that they tried to kidnap, well, they did, they kidnapped Jet. Sean never wanted a thing to do with Jet, never changed a diaper, never bought a bottle, never nothing, never did a thing for Jet. But when he got with this girl, all of a sudden she wanted Jet. And so they came over, picked him up for the weekend and never brought him back. And my husband went into high gear, went downtown, got an attorney. The attorney got with the judge and the sheriffs, and they went and got Jet back. And it's just been a mess.
Yeah, physically, they're going to kick the door in because she wouldn't open it, remember?
Yeah, and that bitch wife of his said she was the babysitter.
Yeah, liar.
Yeah, so anyway, it was a long story. But, you know, but we don't tell Jet to hate him or anything like that. It's just, he's a very, very, he's just a bad guy. Some guys, there's two kind of guys in the world. There's bad guys, there's good guys. He's a bad guy. He's comes from a very overbearing mother, a mother that wouldn't let him play football, wouldn't let him play basketball, wouldn't let him play baseball, wouldn't let him date, hated all his, I mean, she was one of those girls, it was one of those women that was almost incestuously in love with her son, didn't want any girl, hated all of his girlfriends, hated Heather, tried to break them up, unbelievable story, she's psychotic. I mean, Victor never says these words. Would you say she's psychotic?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he never says that. Victor is a man of very few words. He'll always give somebody the benefit of the doubt. Always. I don't care who it is. If you were to say, if she's psychotic, if Victor doesn't think so, he'll say, I wouldn't say that.
If they want to know what she looks and acts like, go see Stuart.
Exactly. I mean, she is absolutely 180% physically, mentally, psychologically, voice, her, unbelievable. I mean, if you saw this woman, you would say, Debbie, that is the actress, the comedian that plays the mother of Stuart on SNL. Is it SNL? No, it's
Mad TV.
You would say that. Everybody knows it. I mean, she looks like her, acts like her, talks like her, everything. And it's, I don't even know if she has a name. All I know is she's Stuart's mom.
Justine.
And she does actually play the role of an amazingly sick, overbearing mother. And this is exactly what Sean came from. This is what he was raised with. And here we go with Stuart and the babysitter. This is exactly what she's like. Identical to what she's like. It's hysterical.
Needs I should know about? Oh, no. Not at all, no. He's just your average little boy. Stash! Your time is over, Stash!
Which brings me to our topic tonight, right after this. But pay attention, because this is what I want to talk to y'all about.
Sure, what does Mama say about sliding down the banister?
I
want
to say.
What does Mama say?
I want to say.
Say it.
I
want to
say.
What does Mama say about sliding down the banister?
Don't slide down the banister, because you'll injure your goo-goo, and that's all that some men have going for them.
That's right, just like your father.
Oh, Stuart, come on over here and meet Brenda. She's the new babysitter.
Hi, Stuart. I'm Brenda. Oh, sweetie, it's okay. I'm just trying to say hi. I'm
the... Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm afraid Stuart's just not very good at meeting new people.
I've even talked to the professionals about it, and they've assured me it's just something that he'll grow out of. And for now, I guess I'm just supposed to use patience and understanding.
Oh, what is it, Stuart?
I hate Brenda, and she's ugly.
Oh, no.
Well, now, Stuart, you haven't even really met her yet. Now, you be a big boy and go on and get acquainted with her. Go on. Go on. Now, Mama's got to go upstairs and put on her jean-noté.
Oh. Yes, it is my first date since
Stuart's father left us on Tuesday, so...
Oh. Whoa. Good for you. Good for you.
Mama. Mama. Mama.
What is this, Stuart?
Mama. Why don't you go out on a date with Daddy?
Why not? Stuart, just no more sugar, okay? Just stay away from the sugar and go on your head. Oh.
Stuart.
And that's his mother. I mean,
the hair.
The hair.
Shaking of the head.
The shaking of the head. Voice. The voice. It's unbelievable. I thought it was her. I mean, everybody that just goes, oh my God. Well, Sean just hasn't taken too well to being a father. He's just a young boy himself. I say he's a grown man, lady. You know, I mean, it's just unbelievable. Sean would never touch drugs. some mothers just need to be slapped. Sean would never touch drugs. The mothers that I want to talk about and the offspring of the mothers that are listening are males, for one thing, and you have an overbearing mother. Now, if you had an overbearing mother as a young boy, you still have an overbearing mother. I'm sure she hates your wife or girlfriend. You probably don't even have one because you don't want to make her mad. Okay. She wants to be the number one female in your life. She wants to remain the number one female, and she doesn't want to have that. I once knew a mother. I still know the mother. Robert's wife. A person that I knew whose son got a girlfriend, and she was going to have her killed. And this little girl was 15 years old. And that's how sick this woman was. But there are some women out there who get married with the sole purpose of having a child. They want a son. And they wrap their entire world around that son. They completely forget about the dad. And that's all they want. They feel like finally they own something that is theirs, that is unconditional. And when somebody comes in and tries to take that away, they don't like that very much. And they do a lot of things to try to get rid of it. Now, I know some of you out there are in denial about this. Oh, my mother just loves me. No, your mother is psychotic. Your mother is sick. It is not normal to overlove and overprotect a son like that. I told y'all 1,000 times, I kicked Steven to the curb when he was about 13. I threw him to Vic. I said, here. And until then, he was my baby. I mean, and he was, people would say, oh, you baby him too much. No, there's a difference. There's a big, big difference. The overprotecting mother, in my opinion, I'm not reading anything. I'm just sitting here talking to you. The overprotecting mother, in my opinion, is not a mother who talks a baby talk to her child. It's a mother who talks to him like an adult, but yet watches every move they make. And controls every move they make by either pitching a little hissy fit or making the life miserable of the person that they're with, which is usually a girlfriend. And God help them if they ever get a wife.
Or pouting.
Or
hurt me.
Pouting.
You're going to do that to your mother.
Now, somebody in the room we all know and love comes from one of those kind of mothers, which is Vic. Victor's mother is extremely possessive of him. I would say on a scale from 1 to 10, she's a definite 8. Tell him he's my son. How many times have I heard that?
Take my ass to the curb, though.
When she used to call me and I would say something like, look, you need to let this go. He's my son. And I would say, okay, but he's now a big boy. He's 37 and he's my husband. I'd be like, he's not your little boy. Anyway, I don't want to talk about that. But anyway, I think this is a epidemic. And women, if you're listening to me out there and you're doing this, please let go. Get over it. Get somebody in your life. Realize that you are, first of all, you're very sick in the head. I don't know where it comes from, but we're going to see if we can find out. We're doing a search right now on the overbearing mom. The overbearing mom is also, let's see, they call it a domineering mother. My mom is in my business. Boyfriend's overbearing mom. Ask the therapist. Oh, let's look at this. Ask the therapist. There is something seriously wrong with this type of woman. She doesn't seem to want her baby to grow up, and she is becoming competitive with you. But the problem isn't really with her. It's your boyfriend. If your guy cannot begin to draw boundaries with his mother, see, this is where Victor stepped in and manned up. Victor finally went over there and said, hey, look. I mean, this woman was so sick. She said, it's either me or her. Victor's like, well, then take a hike. I mean, it's like, how many of you women out there that are listening know that when you have a problem with your boyfriend, with your boyfriend's mother, you don't deal with it yourself. You let him deal with it. If your guy can't begin to draw boundaries with his mother, I don't see that the two of you can ever have a healthy adult relationship. Let's see what the question was. The question was, dear whatever, my boyfriend's mom is really overbearing and it's crazy. She gets mad whenever We don't eat dinner with her when she cooks. One time we were leaving to go stay at my place, and she's like, where are you going? And my boyfriend said, to her house. And she said, her house? And she began to cry. I also fear that when we move out, she is not going to take it very well because she never wants him to move out or accomplish anything. She's always talking to him in a baby voice, and it's creepy. I am so tired of her treating him like he's 2 instead of 22. What gets me really mad is on our anniversary and an important date, she always needs him to do stuff for her and makes him feel guilty. I never feel comfortable when my boyfriend wants to get intimate in their house because she just barges in whenever she feels like it. Well, you shouldn't be doing that anyway. I don't really like this therapist. The therapist says, okay, I'll give you what she says. She says, he, not you, needs to tell her to stop using the antics to respect his time and his friend relationship. Okay, that's not the way you handle this. I mean, I'm talking about, let's get into the mind of the overbearing mother. Let's see what causes them, okay? That's what I want to know. What causes a mother to be overbearing? Sometimes known as the helicopter mom. Overbearing mothers are usually those that make decisions for their children, try to protect them from anything negative, and have specific parenting goals in mind with little room for any flexibility. Understanding why a mom at your mom and me group is so intense can help you better grasp what it means to be an overbearing mom. An overbearing mom might have specific parenting goals in mind that she sets for herself and her children. Clinical psychologist Dominic Maglio points out that an overbearing mom often wants her child to be superior to others and therefore pushes them to excel or to be the best, no matter what the cost. I don't think this is what I'm thinking about. This is somebody that's like Sue in the swimming deal. That's the kind of overbearing mom we're thinking about here. We had a friend named Sue who... we called her Psycho Sue. Everybody called her Psycho Sue because she was Psycho Sue. And she had this daughter that she pushed to be the swimming goddess of Plano, Texas. She got up every morning at 5 o'clock, drove across town for her to have the best swimming lessons in the world. Push, push, push. The daughter never got to be a child. And when she finally graduated from Plano Senior High School, she got a 4-year ride to 5 different Ivy League colleges to swim. She was the best. And guess where she picked? She could have gone anywhere, and she picked Notre Dame. The furthest college she could get from that psycho. From everydaylife.com, how does an overbearing mother affect men? A man's relationship with his mother is important in how he views himself and has strong effects on his interactions with others. An overbearing mother is intensive, overly involved, and undermines the man's sense of autonomy. She will manipulate his will through anger, excessive neediness, high expectations, inflexibility, affirms psychologist Terry Apter, who holds a doctorate in psychology. It is not easy for a man to sever the ties he has with his mother, even if she is difficult. Instead, he is more likely to make efforts to give in to her demands or to keep the peace. A man with a controlling mother will go out of his way to placate her. His mother can make it difficult for him to not bend to her will under the assumption that her way is always the best way. His romantic relationship may feel as if it's being steered by 3 people instead of 2. The more he gives into his mother, the more likely is that his partner will feel as if he constantly puts mother first. One coping mechanism of men with overbearing mothers is to lie. A man will tell his mother what he thinks that she needs to hear, even if it's not true. He will do so to avoid what? The guilt, the anger, the disappointment that she places on him. He can become so used to this practice that he habitually disguises himself in all interactions. He may also project onto his wife or girlfriend by lying to prevent her from getting upset or being disappointed. You know what they say? Find out how he treats his mother. A man with an overbearing mother is likely to find it difficult to balance his time between his mother and his girlfriend or wife. He feels compelled to respond every time she calls. An overbearing mother may try to control every aspect of his life and his relationship. She may try to exert control as to where they spend holidays, how they raise their children, her choice of career, and the type of person that she is, period. His mother may actually be able to get her way. In many cases, he has spent his life depending on her judgments and giving into her demands. But you have to ask yourself, are they helping or hovering? So we go to the effects of the helicopter parent. It is important to understand that an overbearing mother can only exercise the power that she is given. Her son will still be loyal, and here's what you need to do if you're an overbearing mother. You need to look in the mirror and say, I am a psychotic person. And you need to say, this is not normal. This is weird. And this is still not telling me why they are doing this. I think it has something to do with their need for a male in their life or something. Because they don't do it with a daughter. Very rarely do they do it with a daughter. But they always seem to do it with the son. It's just so, I hate it. I can't stand it. I can't stand over. Get over yourself. Let him alone. Ugh. Let's see if we can get into the mind of the psychotic, overbearing mother. I always go, mother. It reminds me of that movie Psycho. Remember Mother? Mother's not going to like you. It was just so sick, the whole thing. Ugh. Let's see. Controlling mothers, overbearing mom. Oh, let's look at this. Overbearing mom quotes. Controlling and overbearing mother quotes. How many times have you heard this? Sorry. Oh, this is funny. Only mothers can think of the physical. Oh, that's just ridiculous. I mean, I don't know. I think it's weird. And I want to show y'all a song, now that we're talking about this, that I have said all my life is absolutely, I mean, nobody could put it better than this. Nobody. And you know what I'm talking about. Some of you out there who know what kind of music I like, which is what? Classic rock. And that is from the album, The Wall, Pink Floyd, the song they call Mother. I don't think it's actually called Mother. I think it's called The Wall, but he tells the story in this song. It's scary. It's exactly what I was telling you about. These sick, psychotic mothers who... who think they... Sorry, I'm getting messages over here. Stop it. Go away. Hold on. Quit talking. Don't look at the screen, Debbie. Okay. Pink Floyd's... who did this one? Was it Sid? I don't know if Sid did this or not. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't. I don't know if Sid wrote this or not. But it was called... We're just going to look it up by looking up Mother. Steven would kill me if I didn't know this. All right, from The Wall, here is what I'm talking about. Take a listen to this. Put perfectly.
Mother, do you think they'll drop the bomb? Mother, do you think they'll like this song?
Especially pay attention when the mother replies.
Mother, do you think they'll try to break my balls? Should I run for president?
should I trust the government?
Album of Pink Floyd, The Wall, by the members of the band. But it's not at this house or the other house. It is locked up in the big safe. And we all know why. Because it's very valuable. I'm sorry, people talking to me. No, Stephen is, as you all know, a huge Pink Floyd fan. He actually went to see Pink Floyd in the year 2012, I believe. It wasn't that long ago. 2012, 2011? And he just knows everything about them. He's pretty cool guy when it comes to stuff like that. But I was going to say, listen to when the mother replies in the song. And I'm sure y'all are all pissed off if y'all are out there listening, going, Debbie, stop interrupting the fucking song. Okay, no more.
She won't let you fly, but she might let you sing. Mama's going to keep baby cozy and warm. Ooh, babe, this mama's gonna help build the wall.
mother didn't need to be so high.
It is so much like his childhood in that he was asthmatic. And when Waters did this, and Sid Barrett, who of course is not with us anymore, but when Waters did this, it was more of an epigee to his life. And it talks a lot of a boy that had... He was very sick as a child. Stephen was so sick as a child, we almost lost him twice. And I mean, he actually almost died. He doesn't talk about it much. He won't talk about it because he doesn't like to remember it. But they're talking about him having a severe asthma attack in this right here.
Thank you.
Yes, I'm watching the video from the wall. It's very scary, very weird, with all the maggots. For those of y'all that have never seen it, you should check it out sometime. It's the actual video that they made. Some people will call it like a movie. So we've gone from Hank Williams III. We've gone from Hank Williams to Hank Williams III. We've talked about overbearing moms, which I think are just ridiculous. And we were talking about that earlier today when I was out there with the family. But we've talked about the Temptations. We've had Heather's music come through. Heather's got a really good, she's got a neat taste in music. In fact, a lot of people think she's got one of the most versatile taste in music that anybody's ever heard in her life. I mean, ever heard in their life. She can go from anything new to anything vintage. And I just think that's really cool when people are not stuck in one genre of music. But, you know, there's so many things that people want me to talk about. Okay, last night, me and Mr. Midnight Movie and Jewish Producer, yes, we got into a little bit of a tiff on the show, but it doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean that we're not friends. It doesn't mean that they're not going to be on my show anymore. It doesn't mean anything like that. It just means that we got in a tiff because I was being, when you hang out, when your two best friends are guys, you have to realize that guys don't like girls too much when they start acting like girls. And I probably was acting like too much of a girl at one point. Well, I was being too sensitive. The song is kind of weird. It is kind of gay. It's kind of stupid. And I understand that when I played it, I was like, oh, y'all didn't like that. But I was acting like a stupid girl. And even though I am a female, it's just something you have to know. I know you guys know what I'm talking about. You just can't do that when you're around them. And then I understand that. I totally respect it too. So to Mr. Midnight Movie and Jewish Producer, if you are listening to this, or if you do listen to this, you mullets, I think I still have better taste in music than both of you do. I don't know. Jewish Producer's got a pretty nice taste in music. Mr. Midnight Movie's got an interesting taste in music when Smokey sings. Oh, I like that song. I like that song. It's not even by Smokey Robinson. It's by some idiot. I don't even know who it's by. It's called When Smokey Sings. And he asked me one time, he goes, don't you love that song? And I'm like, are you joking me? Are you serious? He's like, no, I love When Smokey Sings. It was by a band called ABC, a band that put out a lot of stuff. It's horrible. I hate it.
Shut out of sight, and everything's good in the world tonight. When Smokey sings, I hear violins. When Smokey sings, I forget everything. Ashes packing the fence, ashes spreading the winds. The front door might slam, but the back door it rings. And Smokey sings.
till out of sight. And everything's good in the world tonight. When smoke descends, I feel violence. When smoke descends, I forget everything, yeah. Ashes packing the things, ashes spreading her wings, smashing the hell with the heaven she brings.
I think if it's like 51 or less than 60, you'll see a popcorn, a popcorn thing dumped to the side, like this film, like it'll show a dump, a popcorn cup, or a popcorn lid on its side, a box of popcorn on its side.
Jane screams. Marvin was the only innovator. Nothing can compare, nothing can compare when Smokey sings. When Smokey sings, I hear violins. When Smokey sings,
not always a great thing to be a horny man.
Love that breathing. My buddy, Mr. Midnight Movie. And I promise you, Orange, you're gonna see the difference. When Smokey sings, I think all their songs sound alike. I hear violins. So we have now gone through When Smokey Sings, and now we're gonna go and see what else. What else? You know what I'm dying to hear again? I love that song that Heather played. Who wants to hear it again? You too? Here's our new song brought to us by the beloved and ever powerful Heather, my daughter. It's called I Mean It. And it's by a cute guy named Jeezy. You would have never thought he was a rapper. Pretty good though, I like
it. If I say something, I mean it. These things happen. Yeah.
If I ever said I'm never scared, just know I mean it. If I ever said I fuck your bitch, just know I mean it. And if I ever said I'm
reminds me of? It reminds me of a song. Hang on just a second. Hang on to that one. Stop that one for just a second. Stop it for just 1 second. Thank you. This reminds me of a song I used to play on my show, all the time by, what was his name? His name was... I don't remember his name. Why do I want to say Gorilla? That was his name, Gorilla Zoe. He did a song called... What was that song that he used to sing I loved so much? It was called... Let me look this up. And you're going to see what I'm talking about when you hear the song, because it sounds exactly like... It just sort of... It was called Echo. That's right. And I used to play that all the time on my show because I thought it was really cool. And I had met him in Dallas down at a radio studio here that I hung out with or at. Anyway, he did a song called Echo. And if you listen, excuse me, pardon me, you can hear the resemblance in the two tracks. That's a really good song. I like that a lot. I like the sound of that. I'm trying to see if they've got this on here. Let me see if I can find it. It was called Echo. And I know you're going to all know what I'm talking about when you hear it. By Gorilla Zoe. Let me see if I can find it. I'm not finding it really. Hold on. He was a big, big guy. I don't find it for some reason. I'm drawing a blank here. Let's see if I can find it another way. I used to have it on my system. What did I do with that song? Here it is, from Gorilla Zoe, and the name of the song is Echo, and it sounds quite a bit like what we were just listening to. I think this is the shorter version, but still, nonetheless.
You did it to yourself, now you're all by yourself, acting like you hate me. I love because you made me. You played me to the left, now there's nobody left to hear your complaining. I'm gone, and all you're hearing is your own echo.
Tell y'all something cool about this song. Did y'all know that he was on the best microphone made on this planet? I'll tell you what it is in a minute.
You say it's my fault. Okay, then I'll go. It's better to know. Now it's nobody to argue with. Cause I'm not home. Don't care who you're with. Don't call my phone. Or did you forget? You're wrong. I'm gone. And you're all alone here in your own damn echo. And I'm gone. And you're all alone. Can't you hear the echo? Echo. Nobody near you. It's no one to hear you. Disgusted with trust. I'll just know one no more. Just went with the flow, found myself on the floor. When you went away, all my pain went astray. Like it's a new day, now I have no one to argue with. Cause I'm not home, don't care who you're with. Don't call my phone, or did you forget? You know you're wrong. That you were the one who had issues. So why would I miss you?
Why would I miss you?
To argue with, cause I'm not home. Don't care who you're with. Don't call my phone. Or did you forget? You know you're wrong.
I'm gone.
Sure.
recorded on a Neumann, for those of you that understand what microphones. It was the Neumann Solution D. It retails at $15,000. Yeah, and you can tell by, I've always been told that the cleaner and more natural sounding a person is on a microphone, that's the good. I'm on a Yeti, and you just can't beat them. Actually, one of the best, I kid you not, one of the best microphones put out in the world is the Yeti. It's known as the blue microphone. It's, let me see if I can show you what it is. I'll look it up. It's a blue microphone. Now, I also have the HE. I also have, oh, my leg is killing me. I also have an Audio Technique microphone, but I don't use it that much. I don't know why I don't, but I just don't. It's not all that expensive. It's about a, I don't know, Victor got it for me. It's the Audio Technique 4040. They come in a 2020. I have the 4040. One of the most expensive microphones that you can get, just most people record with a Sony. It's about a $9,000-$10,000 microphone. That's what Howard Stern talks on, is a Sony, just a large diaphragm tube condenser microphone. All that means is that my sound or your sound is bouncing off of a it's a piece of glass. It's like a tube, and it just, I don't understand how they work, but it's pretty hard to understand. I don't really understand how they work, but the blue microphone that I'm talking about that is really nice, and I mean it's one of the nicest microphones you can actually buy. It's about $5,000-$6,000. It's by the company Blue, which is what I'm talking on right now. I'm talking on the Blue Yeti mic. This one, as you well know, is about $150, whatever. Actually, we have, oh, look at this. We have somebody that's going to show us the Blue bottle condenser microphone. It's, I think, I could be wrong. I think it's Blue's top of the line. It's a condenser microphone. My leg is killing me for some reason. And it is fascinating. Let's see what this is. I hope it's what I think it is.
I'm Mike Peacott, sales engineer here at Sweetwater, and I'm here with the Blue bottle. The bottle uses a Class A circuit with a hand-selected tube. Comes stock with a B6 capsule, which is similar to modern vocal sound. One of my favorite features of using this microphone is you can switch the capsules. They do sell a capsule kit, or you can buy them individually. When you have this on a lead vocal, which I tend to use it on personally, I can start with a B6 capsule for that modern vocal, change it real quickly without changing the mic position to a B7, which is reminiscent of a classic 47 type microphone, all the way to a B0, which would be like a Telefunken 251. The microphone is excellent on male vocals, female vocals, but the fact that you can use the interchangeable capsules makes it a great microphone for everything else. Even the B2 can give you a pickup pattern similar to a ribbon microphone. I would recommend trying the bottle out and give it a shot on vocals. And I'm Mike Peacott, sales engineer here at Sweetwater, and I'm here with the Blue bottle.
Shut up.
The bottle uses a clap.
So the Blue microphone is one of the best ones you can buy. That's what I'm on right now. I'm on the Blue Yeti. I'm not on the Yeti Pro. I do have a Yeti Pro, but I'm not using it. The Yeti Pro, the only thing different about it, in my opinion, is that it's solid silver. This one is silver and then dark. It tends to make me sound, in my, I'm probably just making this out of nothing, but I'm making something out of nothing, but I sound too, like, clickly or something. It's too tinny or something. I don't know. But here's another person talking about the blue bottle. They call it the blue baby bottle. There's a baby bottle and a blue bottle, and it looks like a bottle. It's like a tube, and then there's a circle on top. Here's another one.
Cedar Valley, I'm going to review the blue baby bottle microphone with you today. It's dark blue, so it's not black. It kind of looks black in the camera from what I'm seeing, but that's dark blue. That's what it looks like. It comes with that pop filter. It's a really good sound, really clear vocal. I'm going to show you with my wife's voice, my voice, and the guitar what it's going to sound like. It comes with this nice little red wooden box. And it all just slides in there.
Oh, wait, this is cool. This is a vocal mic shootout. The Neumann versus the Blue versus the Rode versus the Audio Technica. Oh, this should be really cool. Let's listen to this.
From my heart to the head.
Okay, this is her on the Neumann U87.
Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
Great voice too.
All about you, from my heart to the heavens.
We already had our Bible study over here today. Victor and I did. We talked about a couple of parts of the Bible. He just asks me these questions and I don't know how to answer him. And so I just go to the Bible and I start reading things in there. And it makes more sense that way. It is Sunday. You know, I have so many people that listen to me that are atheist or agnostic or whatever. And I just, it works for me. I'm very happy with it. I love how I feel about God. And I just believe that he's there and I have living proof of it. I just am. I'm sorry. I told you guys last night in the beginning of my show, something that, and I will go out on a limb and risk losing listeners. I don't care. That's the way I feel about it. In the beginning of my show last night, I talked about my thoughts on Christianity and the reason why I had those certain thoughts. And I said, where did I do it? I said, where was it? I played something and I started talking about it and I wanted to listen to what I said because I've never listened to it yet. He's doing all right. You should have heard him just around midnight. Brown Sugar, how come you taste so good? No, it couldn't have been that. We were already with the guys by that time. I think it was in the very beginning of the show. Let me see. Wait, I know where it's at.
I'll be back on my feet.
Right here. I don't remember what I said. But I remember at the time what I was saying really felt like I meant it. And it made sense to me, and I was hoping that people would respect it for what it was, and here's what it was. Wow, what a powerful song. Such a sad song, too, but I had to put my gum out of my mouth. Because it's such a reality, though, because all of us have been down at one time. You know, a real heartbreaker. When I'm back on my feet again, you know, some people just have some really bad luck sometimes, but I believe that you have to pray. I do. Call me stupid, but it's just what works for me. And you should have seen what I did the other day. The other day I was in here in my office with Victor and I said, you know something? I don't believe in God anymore. He was like, what? I said, it's all a bunch of bullshit. All a bunch of bullshit because I have asked and I have asked for something, and it's just not happening. Okay? And I said, I grabbed the Bible, and I opened it up to Psalm 91, and I read it to Victor. And I said, what I just read to you is a bunch of horse shit. It's a lie. He's not there. He's not listening. Or as Don Henley said, he's not coming and he's never going to. But he was talking about aliens. And so then I started thinking about what everybody that is smart, that is a Christian, tells you. When I was praying, I was just saying, God, help me. Well, what if you were to call me and say, hey, Debbie, it's me, Fred. Can you help me? I'm going to say, help you what? Just can you help me? Help you what? So I got real specific in my prayers, which is what he tells you to do. Ask not. Get not. The Bible says, ask and you shall receive, but you have to be specific. So I prayed specifically for what I needed in life. I needed him to help me with my with my faith, to renew my faith, to do this and do that, several things. And I am proud to tell you that when I prayed that prayer, today is Saturday, I prayed it, I think, Wednesday, everything I prayed for has been answered. Everything. And I was ready to give it up. I even told Victor, I said, I'm going to go on my show and I'm going to say, excuse me, no more. Do not believe in God. It's a bunch of bullshit. Wasn't I, Victor? Mm-hmm. I was going to do it. I was going to say, I'm done. I am done. And then I started thinking, I'm being an idiot. What is God help me? Help me what? Help me take a test. Help me buy a new car. Help you what? And then it wouldn't help if you acknowledged him. You know, and a lot of people say, acknowledge what? Are you breathing? Thank him for that. Have you eaten today? Thank him for that. Do you have a shelter over your head? Thank him for that. Do you have family somewhere? Thank him for that. Give him some freaking credit. I don't know who you are, but I'm going to say hi to you on Skype. Hi. So that's what I was talking about. And I remember saying it at the time. That's right. I remember thinking that now. Because, you know, a lot of people... believing... In God, believing in the God, one God, light from light, true God from true God, maker of the universe, ruler of all mankind, the only God, the God of all gods, is simply forming a personal relationship with him. And then once you get, I guess, convinced, then you want to learn more about how that whole thing happened, which is the study of the Bible. And I think it's just, it's a fascinating book. But I know that there are people that listen to me that claim that it's all bullshit, that it's this, it's that. And I have to respect that. I understand that because there's probably things that they believe in or that I would think is bullshit. And I would respect them respecting me, respecting them. You know what I'm talking about. And yet, on the other hand, I am moved as a person to tell you what it does in my life and for me. I, as you probably both know, As you probably know, I don't go to church. I don't attend a church. I've never really fit in good with them. I've tried several churches and I've been to several churches. And I'm sure that before I turn an old gray-headed person, I will be one of those people that go to church. But it's just not what I need. I don't need fellowship. I don't need friends and all that kind of stuff. I'm very happy in my life the way it is. However, I do stay in constant, I wouldn't say conversation with him, but I've almost kind of got it on my mind a little bit, just a little bit, not a bunch. And about the middle of last week, the wheels seemed to fall off of my life. I'm not going to get real personal here, but I got into a very crooked way with my daughter, her boyfriend, and it trickled down even to her son. I got in a very crooked way with them simply because I was right. No, I just don't have respect for somebody that is in bed at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, not Heather. And just, I don't know. I just, trust me when I say I went off and said some things, you know, I mouthed off and I caused a ruckus. And there was a point when I thought, oops, I've really made a mess. And we can do that in our lives. You can do it. I can do it. We can make a mess in our lives. And it usually always, 99.99% of the time, it has to do with something that we say. And things that we, not so much things that we, I mean, it is things that we do, but a lot of times it's things that we say. We say things to somebody and they think, screw that. That's bullshit. It's hard to stay vigil on watching what we say, but we have to watch what we say. And this really got ugly. It got so bad that Stephen got involved. Stephen, of course, that backed me up. And it wasn't like a big scene where there was screaming and fighting. It wasn't anything like that. It was very low-key, but yet it was very thick, very staticky situation. I, of course, reached out to Victor, pulled him in, and it just got real yucky. Then I started not feeling good physically. As you know, I'm a patient of hypothyroidism, which is a very debilitating disease. You have to maintain strict guidelines on medication, and I am a flighty person. I sometimes forget. Like, for example, I haven't taken it today. I just forget it. I don't understand why I do, but I just do. But I have been doing very, very well, extremely well for me, to be honest with you, because the last checkup I had, which was 2 weeks ago, my thyroid level had gone from negative 800 to negative 50. And that is the best it's ever been in probably 10 years. So physically, I'm feeling okay, but I just took a downturn physically because I had eaten, and I have to watch what I eat. I started eating sugar. And the reason why is because Heather, her boyfriend, had been staying over here, and he loves sweets. He loves sugar. He loves candy. He loves cakes. And she was making him chocolate chip cookies. She made a cake. She made this other thing. She made these little things. And then Victor went over to his sister's house, who has all of these soirees, these parties, these things at her house for these candidates. It's huge election season down here, and she's been having a lot for the Democratic Party, and she has a chef that makes all this stuff. Well, she did something for the Girl Scouts of America, okay, and she sits on the board. Well, they have this thing, if you have this, if whatever, he brought home 3 boxes of, I kid you not, Sprinkles cupcakes. And I don't know if you people have ever had a Sprinkles cupcake, but I had never had a Sprinkles cupcake. And they were in these amazing looking boxes when you open them up. And it said, thank you. There were a box of 12. And these were the most, they are like a premium cake, like a cupcake, with a real thick layer of icing on the top. That is just unbelievable. Well, he brings home 3 boxes of these from this benefit. What do you call it? You know what I'm talking about. Vote for me type thing. And they have all the people come over there. And that's part of what she does. She's on Hillary Clinton's up and coming campaign. She's actually heading up the entire Eastern Seaboard, which is a huge undertaking for her. But trust me, she's the man for the job. She's always just dumping all the food off on Victor and his other brothers, and, you know, come and get this, you know, if it's not eaten. Well, he brought home, so between Heather doing, and I had too much sugar, and it causes me to get into a cycle to where I crash off of it. I feel horrible. When I feel horrible, I tend to act horrible. And you all know that when we feel bad, we act bad. And we abuse the people that are close to us more than anybody. I mean, that's usually the people that we abuse. And I don't mean abuse as in abuse, but, you know, it's like, hi, Mom, how are you doing? You know, and I'll just bark at them. Go help me do this or do that. And I start just getting real, well, I went a little bit overboard last week. And sure enough, I thought at one point I had done irreparable harm. Because my daughter packed up and left with the little one. Of course, we knew where she was. She had gone to stay at Phillips. And I just felt like my world had fallen apart. Now, it's not that I am over possessive of her. She is a grown woman, and she can live on her own any moment that she feels like it. She has her own home, and there are reasons that she likes to stay here. We have the house that we bought has like, it's like a double master situation. She has a master bedroom, and it's a good situation. Trust me. I don't like to get real specific, but, and we all know why, but the emptiness that I felt was really kind of scary, and I didn't know what to do. I didn't know. She had done something too that was pretty vicious. And when you have a child that does, and I know she's a grown adult. Trust me, I know that. I treat her like that. She is respected as an adult, but in fact, she is my offspring. I don't know how you want me to say it. When I say child, I don't mean I look at her as a child. For God's sake, she's not a child, but she is one of my children, okay? And when they do something bad, it's a really strange thing that a mother feels, because you feel bad for what they've done to you, but then you feel bad that they've done that because you feel sorry for them and how they must be feeling. So I was not only feeling the pain of something that I did, but I was also feeling the pain of how she had reacted to me and knew that she was hurting. Does that make any sense? But it was a lot for me to handle. I didn't know where to go. I couldn't call my dad. He's not here. I couldn't call anybody, my mom. And so I, in my anger and in my, not my anger, but in my shortness, I would say, God, please help me. And I would just go about my day or about whatever I was doing. About 2 or 3 days into this, we were at DEFCON 4, and there was no fighting, nothing like that, but it was just a very nervous feeling in the air around here. Even with the dogs, you know, when we have a lot of dogs. And I would notice that Gunner would kind of look at me like, what the fuck? You know, and it's just, and I keep those things to myself. I didn't talk about it last week. I wasn't on the air that much, but if I was, I wasn't talking about it. And I can talk about it now because it's in the past, but let me tell you what I did. I was talking with Victor Thursday here in my office, and I was really not having a very good day. There's other reasons too, but it's there's nothing going on bad or anything like that that I would worry about. But I said to him, you know, I am really sick and tired of this God thing. I'm tired of it. I'm done. And I really did. I picked up my Bible, which is right there, and I opened it up to Psalm 91. And I said, he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High, I started reading it. Psalm 91 is one of the very few times in the book that God himself makes a promise to us, to you, to me. He speaks directly to us through, of course, King David, who, of course, was, we don't even want to go there, but King David was one of the, I believe, was one of the most loved humans by God himself. I believe that God loved David in all of his inequities. David was a cheater. He was a blasphemer. He was an adulterer. He was a murderer of Christians. But yet God set him up. And it was just, anyway, I don't want to bore you to death with the Bible, but he is a history figure. He was actually there. I mean, there's, but anyway. And I opened it up and I read Psalm 91 to Victor. And I knew he was wondering, why the hell is she reading this? And after I read Psalm 91 to Victor, I said to him, what I just read to you, well, first, let me show you what Psalm 91 says, because it is interesting in that, in my opinion, it is one of the only places in the Bible where God himself promises something to me and to you. Psalm 91 goes, a little something like this.
Psalm 91. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. If you say, the Lord is my refuge, and you make the Most High your dwelling, no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent.
Okay, here's where the promise comes. I just wanted to let you guys know.
Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation.
I took my Bible and I tossed it down in the middle of the room on the floor, and I said, it's bullshit. It's not true. And I have lied to my children, and I have lied to a lot of people that listen to me on my podcast. And I was done. I was that done. I don't know what happened after that. We went about our day, whatever. And later on that night, I literally was sitting on my bed. I was laying across the bed, on top of the bed, on my stomach. And I looked up for some reason in all my madness at the moment, and I saw a little thing that Heather had given me that said, "Be still and know that I am God." And yet, no matter how hard I tried, I could not drown out any noise, all the noise that was going on in the world. I could hear the air conditioner. I could hear foo-foo moving around. I could just hear stuff. And so what I did is I did what I used to do. I plugged up my ears. And I just sat there and I thought, God, I need you to help me with my daughter. And I went into this long conversation with him about everything. I said, this, that, I must have prayed five different topics. And then I acknowledged him for what he is in my life and for the honor and the praise and the glory that he deserves. And I let it go. And I think I went on my business and did something, whatever. I forgot about it the next day. My next day went by. Nothing really happened. And then all of a sudden, I was driving down Interstate 30. And I had a text message come across my phone. And it was from my daughter. And then one thing went from there. And ABC, 1, 2, 3, click, 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 click. About 4 hours later, I said to myself, I'll be damned. He heard me, because I was feeling so physically good for no reason. I had done anything different, that I went and I didn't go running, but I went walking with one of the dogs for quite an extended walk. And I went and I began cleaning house, and I cleaned just amazingly. I mean, I felt so energetic, and I thought, I'll be damned. Then Stephen came in. Stephen had this great news of something that had happened with him at work. Victor came home. Everything just seemed to click when I suddenly looked up, and in the Circle Drive, there she was. And she just comes bouncing in the door, you know, hey, you know, and just like nothing ever happened. Like nothing ever happened. And I thought to myself, coincidence? Because I had done nothing to make this better. I had sent no flowers, cards, cookies, nothing, apologies, nothing. Nothing had been done by me. Nothing had been done by her. Just all of a sudden, it was as if it was just all over. And peace again just sort of fell over my home and over my world. And so I told Victor, I said, I guess I don't need to say that I was kind of wrong about what I said the other day. I kind of, oops, you know. Because there is a part when he says, because you love me, I will rescue you, I will protect you. Because you acknowledge my name, you will call on me, and I will answer you. I will be with you in trouble, and I will deliver you and honor you with long life. I will satisfy you and show you my salvation. And what is the prerequisite? Because you love me, acknowledge. The verbs are love, acknowledge, call, and seek. And that's really all there is to it. And I believe that if you are out there and you don't want to believe in God, it's like anything, try it. And I don't see how I'm ever going to make it down here without this, and I don't see how anybody else does. I mean, I guess you've got some sort of thing you do. Maybe you survive by whatever. I don't see how. I don't think I would have done it. I mean, not that my life is over. I don't see how anybody does it without him. Knowing that there is somebody that is that great and that powerful on my side, and that I can go to and talk to, just like he is a father, just like he's my dad. You know, I mean, not that my father could have done anything, but maybe if you look back and think about it, I don't know. I would have to say that in the midst of the storm would, yes? Did you need something?
Me?
Yeah, you. The bow-legged one.
So you have any Halloween junk in here?
No, I don't.
Okay.
Why?
Oh, putting it all in those cartons.
Oh, okay. Why don't you make like a tree and leave? No, I'm joking. You know, I'm sorry. No, I don't have anything, baby. I don't think. I mean, look, no. Don't reckon I do. I am diddle diddle dumpling my son John, one shoe on and one shoe off and one shoe on. Okay, in the throes of it would be, let's see, Thursday. Would be right here. This would be in the absolute middle of the, because I didn't do anything the night before that, Wednesday. This would have been the bad part. Let me see if we can tell if there's any difference in the way I conduct myself and knowing that this is in the middle of the bad part. This is me at my worst. Hey there, everybody. Starting the show off without a song tonight because it's Thursday Throwback with Debbie. And you want to talk about an impromptu show? Wow. I just literally decided to do this show 5 seconds ago. I was sitting around my house going, what am I going to do? Well, I'll just do one of my little shows here, one of my little podcasts. And bunch of stuff on my mind, a lot of stuff I really don't want to talk about, to be honest with you, because a lot of it's... Did you hear that? That's right. I said there's a bunch of stuff going on, a bunch of stuff on my mind that I really don't want to talk about.
It's more personal in my life going on, things like that, but I'll see if we can come up with something to talk about here. I am on Skype right now. The call-in number to the show is 214-444.
So there's your girl at her worst. I mean, I'll tell you what, I last week, that might have been the lowest I think I'd ever been. I mean, I've been pretty low, trust me, but that was definitely one of the lowest. Would you agree, Vic?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm, he said. He knows what I'm talking about. He just doesn't want to talk about it. I understand that. He's a very quiet, private person. I understand that. But I was telling him just little teensy Vince's pieces, like just giving me hints as to things that were going on. And I said, last week, the wheels fell off this deal.
Yep.
And I had just totally forgot how to help, how to reach out for help. Instead of going, oh, God, help me. He's like, fuck you. What do you mean help you? Shut up. Get out of here. Handle it yourself, you stupid bitch. You know, that's the way he probably thinks. Don't call me. Help me. What is that? Go away. Until I sat down in quiet and said, okay, look, here's what's going on. He's not an idiot. He's not. He can be an asshole. There's no doubt about it. I mean,
it's kind of like the guy in the house. His house is flooding, and they send the.
Oh yeah! No! Wait! That wasn't the house flooding. No, He was stranded in the middle of the ocean on a desert island. And he prayed, God help me. And God was like, okay. So he's, and then the next day a helicopter came over and they said, do you need some help? He said, no, I'm waiting on God. God's going to help me. I just know he's going to show up any moment. And the next day a cruise line came by and said, burr, burr. You know, do you want to? No, he was trusting in God. And he drowned and he went to heaven. And he said, God, what's the deal? He said, I sent a helicopter. I sent a boat.
That's right.
So, is that a fly on the printer? It is, isn't it? Is it?
Yeah. Like,
oh, that's weird. We've never had a fly in here before.
We got all the doors open, taking all the Halloween stuff out.
Oh, well... And it was, you know, that was like me. Help, God. He was like, help what? And then I, like I said, I just.
Many times he'll send you help, but you've got to recognize it.
Or he'll ignore you. And think, quit acting like an idiot. Quit acting like a mullet and maybe things will calm down. Shut the F up. You know? I don't know. You should read the book of Job sometime if you really want to know what I'm talking about. Job was a great, great, great man. And the book of Job tells how Job was out looking around going, man, I am a badass. He was a very godly man, though. He had the most beautiful wife in all the land of, was it Syria or Iraq, one of those places. Anyway, he had 7 beautiful daughters, 7 or so, so many gorgeous, strong sons. And one day, a tornado came, killed his wife, killed his daughters, killed his sons, wiped out all of his cattle, all of his sheep, or oxen, whatever they called them back then. And he went, okay, what did I do? Well, come to find out, the story goes that God was tempted by Satan by saying, so you think Job is pretty tough, huh? Pretty cool. And he said, let me mess with him. Let me go in there and see if I can stir him up. And he did. God said, do anything you want to do with him. Tear him down. And he did. And he said, he will never bow down to you. Well, Victor just reminded me that during the throes of this, I was in the garage one. No, I was in the driveway one day in the back of my house. Well, anyway, I was behind the house. And I said, and Victor goes, I've never heard you say that before. I said, you know, Satan, you can fuck with me all you want, and I will never bow down to you, because any day God's going to show up. It may be 5 days from now, it may be 10 days, it may be a year, but I don't care what you do. I mean, I do care. I'm not testing you. I'm not pushing you, because I don't mess with evil, because evil is powerful. It's not as powerful as God, but it is powerful, and I have respect for it only by virtue of the fact it's a respect of not fear, but a respect of you stay over there and I'll stay over here. I don't tempt it, is what I'm saying. I don't say, oh, well, fuck you. You know, I'm not like that, because I know that the more you bloviate about believing in God and trying to do good things, that's when they will get you in their crosshairs and think, she needs to be quieted down. She needs to be shut up. Because according to everybody, we are getting into the final stage, you know, the back nine of this whole deal. We're getting into the final quarter, the whatever, and that means he's going to turn up his game. Because it gets down to them two. Excuse me, I'm over here just I don't know what I think I'm hungry. It gets down to those two going at it. And it's going to be good. I don't know. I am not a preacher. I'm not an evangelist. God help me. I'm not anything like that. All I am is just a person who just sits here with a blue Yeti microphone and a big fat weenie dog right here. The weenie dog's in here tonight. His name is Little. And he looks like a sausage. He's a gigantic fat weenie dog. But and that's all I am. And I'm just talking to you about things that I go through and whatever, and hope that maybe somebody out there that's listening will know what I'm talking about and give it a try. But if your life's falling apart, if your life sucks, you can't find a job, you can't pay your bills, your girlfriend hates you, she is a bitch, she might have even left you, you hate everything around you, you are so strung out on dope, everything's wrong, well, I tell you what you need to do. You are in the throes of a hellstorm. Here's what you need to do. You need to get real still and say, okay, look, I don't know you personally, but I know that you're there. And I'm not going to be any kind of a choir boy here. I'm not going to do anything that might be expected out of me. I'm not going to go and start singing, you know, bringing in the sheaves or whatever. But if you don't mind, would you please help me to whatever? And then, you know, without expecting some sort of, and I was always taught, you never expect any sort of a miracle, you know, thing. He's not a genie in a bottle that can be rubbed in a lamp. That's not the way he operates. But he does respect and love his creation just as you do your own children and just as your parents loved you. And he does not want to see you getting your ass kicked down here in a world that he knows is bad. He knows it's tough. He knows what it's like down here. And he's watching. Even if you make mistakes, he's watching. And he's looking down and thinking, how's that working for you? Huh? Uh-huh. You've tried everything else. Now you're going to call me, huh? When in fact, it should be the other way around. But I'm not a perfect person. I am, shit, I'm nowhere near perfect. I'm probably closer to the other end. But I know that when things get really bad, and I know that there's somebody out there listening whose things are really bad right now, even though you're like, oh, it's not bad. Bullshit. All I can tell you is what works for me. I mean, I was ready to give up. I was like, screw this shit. I even took my Bible. I threw it across the room. I said, fuck that. I mean, and you know, oh, Debbie, that's so sacrilegious and that's blasphemous. Well, okay, but he understands. He knows me. He knows Debbie. He knows me. He knows me better than I know me. And he knows what I need to do. And he's not going to spoon feed me. He's not going to make things all pretty and better and have me not have asked for it. That gives him no glory. And therefore, when I ask for help, send up a 911, the bat signal, whatever you want to call it. And whenever it happens and things begin to move and shake in my life by not me doing it or not by somebody else coming in and help, not Dr. Phil coming in, nothing like that, then I know that that's what it's for. And it is my responsibility in my own heart. I mean, this isn't written, that I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to acknowledge that. And I am acknowledging to you, to me, to anybody listening, that he did move in my world last week in a big way. And it hasn't happened like that in quite some time. And it was a direct result of me. And you don't have to light candles or make the little praying pose, like put your hands together. You have to do nothing like that. He doesn't care how you talk to him. You can even say, "Dear God, my life is fucked up." You know, a lot of people would say, "Oh my God, would you say that to God?" He knows you. He knows me. He's not going to judge you and say, "Did she just say fuck to God?" You know, that's your church. That's why I don't go to... People are so judgmental in those churches. Those old women that go, those old blue-haired women that are in those churches are like, "Oh, she's wearing that," you know, or "she said that," or "she..." It's just she. And I hate it. The last time I went to church, I swear to you, I'm telling you the truth. The last time I attended a church, I went with a girl named Cindy. We won't mention names, but her name was Cindy. And it was recent. Y'all knew me when I went. She talked me into going to the adult Sunday school and then going to the service, the worship service. I went, and there was leading the adult Sunday school class was a guy I knew in high school. His name was Mark. There was a time a little bit before high school, I think we were like freshmen or even maybe in middle school, that I was kind of sweet on the guy. I knew him. I mean, we never dated. We were never intimate, for God's sake. But I knew him, and he knew me, and he knew that I thought that he was cute and that I liked him. And he even kind of got sweet on me later on about sophomore or freshman year. We never went out again. But when he was talking to the class, I raised my hand to ask him a question, and I said, "Mark," and I asked him a question. And then later on, they were just all talking, and I said, "Do you remember me?" And he very, very adamantly said, "No." And sitting to my left, which I didn't know this woman, was this 300-pound woman that was sitting there scowling at him. And I thought, I couldn't get over it. I thought, "Yeah, you do know me." And like I said, we never went out or anything like that, but he was kind of a cute guy. He played football and all that kind of stuff. And I know he knew who I was. And I thought, what a pussy to not even acknowledge me, being scared of his wife. And so I'm not going to go and let somebody teach me that's not even man enough to say, "Hey girl, how are you doing?" You know, or whatever. So I don't like church people. I just don't. And when Victor and I were regularly attending church at one point, when the children were young, they were raised in the church. They were raised in Mother's Day Out programs. They were put in little, you know, "Jesus loves me, this I know," all that kind of stuff. They were raised that. They were baptized, all that. There were always these, this group of women that never felt right for me for some reason. I don't know. I'm not better than them. I think they're better than me in a lot of ways. But so no, I don't do church. But I still maintain some sort of a really stupid relationship with him. I don't know what it is. But I just wanted to acknowledge that and tell you guys about it. And I'm talking to a select group of people out there. And you know who you are that I'm talking to. And it's not trolls or the mean people. It's some people that I know that listen to me. So, right. Good. We good? That's it. All right. I'm going to let Heather's song take us out. That my back is killing me. I'm going to go in there and get something to eat. I'm starving. Even though we went to Cece's Pizza earlier. But when I go to Cece's Pizza, I eat pizza and I just like, I'm sick of it. I'm tired of it. And then 2 hours later, I'm hungry. But here we go with G-Eazy. with I Mean It. And I'll see you guys the next time we do this. Shouts out to Mr. Midnight Movie and Jewish Producer. My two sweetest sweethearts in my podcasting world.
If I say that shit, then I mean it. She calls me, I screen it. I'm only fucking if it's convenient. You lying pussy, that's weak shit. We pass pussy round, that's G shit. But you ain't fam, so what is this we shit? You cuff yours and Elise shit. Listen, I'm telling you, it's my world. I does what I wish to. If you're mad, well, too bad. Sounds like a personal issue. I walk in, they all stare like, who the fuck is this dude? Kick's game is just rude. Don't get jujitsu'd. Tunnel visions, I get ahead. Stay solid, I never fled. My haters feel like I'm better dead. But I'm quite alive, getting bread instead. With a better girl, with a better face, I'm in a better place. Getting better head. I just wanna stay broke forever. Yeah, that's that shit no one ever said.
Never scared. Just know I mean it. If I ever said I fuck your bitch, just know I mean it. And if I ever said I'm getting money, just know I mean it. And oh Lord knows, he knows I mean it.
Gerald, I'm sincere. This year, I'm in here. I'll spell it out to make things clear. And meanwhile, your end's near. I've got a lane and I'm in gear. You people wonder who's next up. That conversation really ends here. You rappers just talk a bunch. Stress me out, I chop a Dutch. Weak rappers trying to bite the sound, but my style is a lot to munch. And I'm more like whiskey neat, and you're more like vodka punch. G's dope, you might blow up. Think I know, I've got a hunch. On my side, it's authentic. You try to stomp it, it's all rented. Sure dope, you got a bad chick. Yeah, cool, bro, we all get it. She wears a ring, can't do without it. You really think she stays true? I doubt it. Cause I'm fucking your girlfriend, and there's nothing you can do about it.
You keep slapping that bass.